Welcome to another edition of Critical Insight on Your World News. I'm your host, Solomon Kamajan, and it's an honor to be joined on this special episode by Dr. Dahlia Wasfi. And Dr. Wasfi, it's an honor to have you on. Welcome to Critical Insight on Your World News.
Thank you so much for having me. Really, the honor is mine.
No problem. Thank you. The first question I wanted to ask you is, can you give our viewers a better idea of who you are, your background, and how that background in particular shaped who you are as an activist and some of the issues that you focus on when you speak out and the activist work that you do in general?
Absolutely. I'll try to keep it a short story, but I tend to get long-winded, so
that's
jump
all
in
right.
If it goes too long. my background is on my mother's side. My grandparents were Holocaust survivors. They were born and raised in Austria, and they had to flee as Jews when Hitler's Anschluss came, which was basically the occupation of Austria, and the Nazis annexed Austria to Germany. So this was 1938. My grandfather got out in 38, and he helped. He came to New York, helped my grandmother come over, and many members of her family. And they got a second shot at life here in the U.S. And they had my mom and my uncle, her younger brother. And my mom was born and raised in New York and grew up in a traditional Jewish, which was also a traditional Zionist household that believed the motto of the Zionist movement that Israel was created as, was built on a land without a people or a people without a land. But the problem with that is that wasn't true, and that people were living there, and they were the same way my grandparents were ethnically cleansed from Austria as Jews. Palestinians were ethnically cleansed from historic Palestine to pave way for the establishment of the Jewish state. But this was a narrative that my mom never heard growing up. Until she started a master's program in D.C. At the School for Advanced International Studies, Johns Hopkins. And there she lived at the International Student House, where there are a number of students from all over the world, including the man who would be my father, who was born and raised in Basra, Iraq. So his upbringing was during the time of World War II, but from a very different perspective. Iraq was occupied by the British during that time, so he grew up in a very revolutionary time opposing occupation, but he also was quite familiar with the Palestinian narrative and what had happened. So when my parents met, that was the first time my mom heard a different story about the establishment of the State of Israel. And that really opened her eyes to a lot. My parents met in 1963. They got married in 1968, which was a huge problem for my mom's parents. And eventually things got smoothed over, especially by the time I was born. But there was always underlying friction between my grandmother, my mom's mother, and my father. And so very naively, as a young kid, I picked up on this. And I sort of took it upon myself to try to resolve this problem, not having any clue of what was underlying the whole situation. And specifically for that interaction, my grandmother was ignorant of the facts, may she rest in peace, but there was a lot of racism directed towards my father simply as an Arab. So it very much shaped who I was and shaped my early life to observe this dynamic in my family. So I thought, you know, I want to try to fix this. As I got older, I learned the bigger picture of what was going on, but there was still, it was more complicated in some respects, but there was an inherent injustice in what was happening, what had happened and was continuing to take place in Palestine. But I was living the American dream and also pursuing a career that my parents were happy with. And I went to college and medical school and was doing residency training. But at this time, I'll skip over the first Gulf War, which I sort of, I was very much just focused on myself during that time. And in the build-up to the 2003 shock and awe invasion of Iraq, it really hit me for the first time what my tax dollars were paying for. And I really, like, I sort of relived the difficulty of my experience being here in the U.S. during the first Gulf War. But that, this time, I could not turn a blind eye to what was happening. And I ended up taking leave from my training. And for the first time, I wasn't in school or working. And inspired by the story of Rachel Corey, who was a young college student, 23 years old, who went to occupied Palestine to get a firsthand look of what was happening there, and who ended up being crushed to death as she was practicing civil disobedience, trying to prevent the demolition of the home of a Palestinian pharmacist and his family, who she'd been staying with. And I thought of her courage, and I was very much struck by her story, and I thought if she went halfway around the world to connect with people with whom her only link was humanity, then maybe I should go see my family. We had lived in Iraq when I was very little, so I was 5 years old, and so I went back for the first time in 2004, spent 3 weeks with my family in Iraq in 2004, and then went back for a three-month stay in 2006. And after my first trip, I was very much inspired to try to do anything I could to try to help my family. They were not just, I had a few memories from when I was little, but many of my cousins were born after we left in 1977. And I have this very strong connection to them at this point and wanted to do anything I could to protect them, especially since it was my government and the U.S. military responsible for their suffering in addition to the British. But I knew I had the privilege of being an American. I also did not have a foreign accent like my father did, and I wanted to try to do something for them. So I just started, I connected with a local peace group where I was living at the time, and I just started showing pictures to try to put a human face on the Iraqi people. And then over time, by word of mouth, I would get more and more invitations. And then after my second trip in 2006, I had an opportunity to testify at a congressional forum. And once that video, the 5-minute video, once that got posted on the internet, then I really started to get more attention. So it was not a planned foray into activism. It's just sort of, I was driven to try to do something, and then the path just sort of unfolded in front of me, and I feel very fortunate to have had the opportunities that I have to try to give a voice, especially because of what's been done in my name. I see it as my obligation.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Appreciate your candor. I want to lead into another question. You know, I'm sure we all understand, well, some of us understand the effectiveness of the U.S. propaganda system, probably the most impressive propaganda system in history. You know,
yeah.
I think Joseph Goebbels would be blushing with
anger. Yeah.
Very, very much so. And because of that, a lot of Americans continue to be obsequious to whatever their media, their corporate, not their, well, yeah, it's a commonwealth, but you know, the corporate media, what the corporate media feeds them, as well as whatever comes out of the Pentagon, the State Department, or the White House. And so the question I want to ask you, somebody who has been on the ground in Iraq, I think the last time you were there was 2006, what should people know about what is going on currently on the ground right now in Iraq, especially given the fact that propaganda with the whole Operation Iraqi Freedom, it leaves the false impression that, you know, these people were liberated, you know, and that things are peachy keen, things are going great there. But that's, I believe that's far from the narrative. Can you tell us what's going on presently in Iraq?
Sure. Well, I can speak about the big picture, unfortunately, because I haven't been able to go back yet a number of reasons, but the main thing being security. I can't tell you exactly what's happening. And also, as I understand it, it varies very much from place to place, even in neighborhoods, because of our invasion and occupation. There are hundreds, maybe even thousands of militias that have emerged in Iraq since the invasion. And these militias have taken over various areas. So you then, for your own survival, you basically have to answer to a militia. So I think the conditions vary from place to place. But the big picture of what we did was essentially to destroy the fabric of Iraqi society and set back Iraq for decades, if not centuries. And that's from a standpoint of infrastructure. Still to this day, there are limitations on electricity. And in the desert, you need pumps to bring water to the individual homes. It was quite a contrast in my last trip to see these massive water towers in Kuwait City, which I traveled to Iraq through Kuwait. And Kuwait is, of course, a very wealthy state thanks to its collaborative politics with the United States and the West in general. But just like we have here in the U.S., you have these huge water towers that supply water to a city. But in Iraq, because of the extensive destruction of the 8 years of the Iran-Iraq War, then the first Gulf War, then economic sanctions, then the 2003 invasion and then occupation, people are still relying on using pumps, electric pumps, to draw water to tanks on the top of their home. So they're kind of like oil-sized barrels, like oil barrels, like that's the size, and most homes have them sitting on the roof. So they still require electricity to pump water to their homes, and when the electricity is gone, that's a limit as well. So it was really, Iraq was on really achieving the caliber of a first world nation prior to 1991, the first Gulf War. And from an infrastructure standpoint, Iraq was set back. From a human rights standpoint, I should clarify to say women's rights, because certainly the regime of Saddam Hussein was responsible for tremendous human rights violations. Up until August 2nd, 1990, all with our funding and tacit approval. But nevertheless, the security that Iraqis had under the Ba'athist regime was gone once the occupation began. And this is what allowed the emergence of various militias and criminal gangs roaming the streets. And this took a significant toll on the segments of the population who suffered the most when there was no law and order, and that's women and children. Their rights were considerably set back, not only because of the increase in violence, but because Iraq had a secular government under Saddam Hussein, and that switched to have more of a religious influence with the government that was installed while we were in charge. So that's one of the ironies of this concept of liberation. Technically, we liberated them from clean water and electricity and security, and we brought them tremendous violence and suffering. They're very general estimates, but based on the reports that we do have, there's an estimated 1.2 to 1.5 million dead since the 2003 invasion. There were another between 1.2 and 1.8 million Iraqis who died during the years of sanctions from malnutrition, starvation, or lack of access to basic medical care because the hospital system was was strangulated, even though we were supposed to let in food and medicine during those years. We blocked that, the U.S. and the U.K. So that's a total of, since 1991, of over around 3 million dead. Then there's been massive displacement, probably 5.5 million, maybe over 6 million refugees, both external refugees and internally displaced persons within Iraq. And this is all of that. Those are hardships in and of itself, in and of themselves, but they contribute to severe mental stress, severe traumatic stress. These are people who have lost family members, lost friends, lost their neighborhoods. The sectarian divisions, which were the architects of the sectarian death squads, were the occupation forces. Prior to 2003, this Sunni-Shia war was not existent in Iraq. As a matter of fact, since the time that the sects were established 1,400 years ago, there had not been a battle of Sunni versus Shia fought in Iraq. There had definitely been wars of empire and wars of conquest. There's no question about that. But one person killing another person because they were from a different sect, no, that was not happening before 2003. One person marrying another person from a different sect. This was the case throughout much of Iraqi society. And even in my own family, my father's parents, my grandmother was Sunni and my grandfather was Shia, and they had 10 children together. So, you know, something worked out, all right. Nobody died. So this is definitely the age-old tactic of divide and conquer, which has, again, using the concept of destroying the fabric of society, was that this is now, Baghdad, for example, is divided up into ghettos. You have Sunni areas, you have Shia areas, you have Christian areas, and this is what we brought. This is the division that we brought to the country. Now, those splits are very deep-seated now, there's no question. But many of the death squads were armed and funded and trained by U.S. Special Forces. So this was not there before we showed up. One of the big premises of the invasion, though our news didn't tell us, was to basically impose an economic occupation once the military occupation had ended. And this is that's a phrase I'm using from a speech given by Hassan Jemaa Awad, who was president of the Basra Oil Workers Union. It was actually from a piece in The Guardian, but I used it in one of my speeches, so that's why it sticks with me. But this was his words, that, you know, we don't want the economic occupation once the military occupation has ended. And technically, we have removed all combat troops from Iraq, all American combat troops from Iraq. But that's a distortion of what the reality is on the ground, because we have this massive embassy there, as if we have diplomatic relations with the country we've conquered. But this embassy staffed several thousand people. Like every other embassy around the world, there are U.S. Marines who are specifically trained to guard that embassy. And then, of course, there are thousands of mercenaries still operating on the ground. And I don't have any definitive proof, but I have no reason to believe that the CIA that was operating, and perhaps Mossad as well, the Israeli secret agency, that they are still operating within Iraq and sort of coordinating the civil society institutions that are on the ground. Not all of them, but you can see it's pretty easy just on an internet search to the connections. There's only 1 or 2 degrees of separation to the U.S. State Department. So it's been a tremendous tragedy, certainly for Iraqis, but because we're so, I would say generally speaking, so ignorant of history, and not to mention geography, in the United States, and I'm a product of the U.S. educational system, this is really a tragedy for human history. Knowing that this is the cradle of civilization, that the looting of the National Museum was the looting of human history, the artifacts of human history, and so this is sort of the product, you know, that as you and I were mentioning earlier, when we talk about the violence of society, and what we have exported around the world, that this is, you know, if it's to borrow a phrase from Malcolm, if it's the chickens coming home to roost, but you cannot live your life and conduct a society so violently. And it's not only around the world. There's tremendous issues of even police brutality here at home. But we can't stand back when a tragedy happens, whether it's the recent shooting in Newtown, Connecticut, which killed 26 people, 26 or 27, I want to get the number wrong, or the shooting before that in an Oregon mall, I think, and then the shooting before that in Colorado. I mean, we can't really say, like, oh, why are these people so violent? This is a long time in the making. We've been violent for a really long time. It's just that if we've exported it, or it is hidden in cities or amongst the poor, and they really only draw people's attention when it's an area that you would think it would not happen, and that's it. I want to be careful that that's probably a prejudiced statement reflecting my own society, but that's sort of the mind frame that we're in, and unfortunately I've been just as receptive to the American or negative stereotypes as anybody else. But this is an idea of, like, oh, well, you know, violence happens in the cities, and violence happens, you know, away from from the privileged, and when it strikes the privileged, that's a real aberration that takes people by surprise.
Right, and you know what you just said towards the end really kind of prompted me to ask you this question, in regards to the recent tragedy in Newtown, Connecticut, and you know, any time, you know, a child, especially children, you know, 6 and 7 years of age, you know, dying, you know, at the hands of multiple gunshots is a tragedy in and of itself, and deserves mourning. But here is where the double standard comes in. So I wanted to ask you is that we see, you know, Barack Obama, his initial, you know, press conference that he had, I believe, on Friday, and I read the transcript, and then the press conference that he had yesterday. He was in Newtown, Connecticut. I don't recall him ever. And so here's the thing, if we all value children's lives, regardless of whether they're in Basra or whether they're in Kandahar or in Tripoli or in Newtown, Connecticut, the same, then we mourn together. But I've never seen President Obama or his predecessor, George Bush, or any president before that, mourning the catastrophic loss of life, especially lives of children under the age of 18, 17, 12-year-olds, 13-year-olds, perishing at the hands of drones. We know that Obama has orchestrated more drones than Bush ever did, but yet he seems to continue to get this pass from all of his supporters, making excuses. The same supporters that were out in front, you know, demanding an end to the wars, you know, during the Bush regime. But now, you know, Obama can get there and can go in front of everyone and not utter any words in regards to the catastrophic loss of life and the life of youth in these places where his drones have unfortunately made their way and destroyed human life and infrastructure that can't ever be replaced. What are your thoughts on that hypocrisy?
Well, that's it. You just summed it up. You know, and the thing is that's particularly hard, it wasn't just from a personal view. It wasn't so hard to see Bush's ignorance because, I mean, the guy is really, like, was out of it. And I'm like, well, in my opinion, Cheney was really the one pulling the strings in that operation and amongst and his cabal of neoconservatives. But it's really hard to hear from Barack Obama because this guy's intelligent. He has to have a clue about what he's doing. And so that's really, but, you know, he's a politician. And I think, like in most places, you have to be wary of politicians. I mean, he is a figurehead, but it works. I mean, especially after Bush. I mean, I know so many people were just, there was concern. There was concern, but even especially from the peace movement, people really thought that, you know, the Messiah has arrived.
Right.
And Obama is going to fix everything, and our work here is done.
Right.
And there were a handful of us. I mean, I was paying close attention, which I generally didn't do prior to my activism days, but I wanted to know what he had to say about Iraq, and I knew what he said when he was running for the Senate, and I knew that he said that he was in opposition to invading Iraq, but he never said he was going to pull out. He always said we will maintain a force there, and people would get up right when I was saying things like that and saying, you know, Obama's not going to end the occupation. People get up and leave.
Yeah.
And these are supposed to be the, you know, my strongest allies. It's in the peace movement. But we were so excited to have a president who had a strong command of the English language. That really, like, that lulled a lot of us into a stupor. But he has really, he's very charismatic, a fantastic speaker. I mean, he's a really, and a very intelligent guy. But he continues the occupation of Iraq until the Iraqis said, no, we want you out. That's the only reason the U.S. combat forces officially left. He expanded our presence in Afghanistan by 30,000. He, as you already described, expanded the use of drones in Pakistan, in Yemen, in Afghanistan. I would imagine they may be in Iraq as well. I just don't have any confirmations of that. So don't quote me on that. And along with NATO as allies, killed thousands in Libya and performed another illegal regime change. And now we're threatening Syria and Iran, and he's doing it all with a bigger Pentagon budget than Bush has. So this has basically been, and I'm not the first one to say it, but I'm going to say it because I think it's a very intelligent phrase, but this has been Bush's third term. The figurehead may change, but the policies have maintained. I left out that we stand by and do nothing while the Israelis continue their assault on occupied Palestine. I shouldn't say we do nothing. We send more arms and more funding to support that illegal occupation. But this is absolutely, Obama is doing his job to sort of guide the American public towards a certain conclusion and towards sort of, I guess, to steer us away from the reality of what we are doing. By that, I mean, that's his job. He's doing a great job. Unfortunately, as you said it very clearly, it's just purely hypocritical. It's one thing to be hypocritical, but when thousands upon thousands are dying, that's a problem. And this is the understatement of the year. Not that long ago, UNICEF issued a report, United Nations Children's Fund, which I don't defend the policies of the UN, but their research tends to be pretty well grounded. And UNICEF issued a report that there's now more children who are killed in wars today than official soldiers. I'm not talking child soldiers, that's another whole issue, but unarmed civilians. Unarmed civilians are 90% of the casualties of war, and this has increased significantly since the first part of the 20th century. So 90% of the casualties, of the fatalities of war are unarmed civilians, and approximately a third of them are children, making more children casualties than official soldiers. So in that big picture, on a global scale, you know, like Obama says, we got to come together and take meaningful action. Like, yeah, we do. But let's look at the whole globe and our interaction with it, not just, you know, even though it's what we usually do, we can't just focus on ourselves. It has far-reaching implications. As far as our military can fly and sail and travel.
Right. And you're a medical doctor, and so you for one, greatly know the impact that it has on children's lives if they have no access whatsoever to clean or sanitized water, medical supplies. And so, you know, as we, and this is nothing new, we can, you know, harken back to the famous 60 Minutes interview with between Leslie Stahl and Madeleine Albright, you know, one of the long list of cretins that have filled the slot of Secretary of State, where she, you know, she basically justified the loss of life of a half a million Iraqi children. Can you tell our viewers what kind of impact the U.S.-led invasion of Iraq has had on children's lives? Like, how many children have been killed, and how is it affecting them even today in terms of health care and also education?
I want to clarify that I visited an Iraqi hospital in 2004, but I have not visited another one since then, and my trips to Iraq were not in the capacity of being a doctor. I was actually doing my training in anesthesiology when I left my training in 2002, so I just want to give that caveat. But I do understand. I have I did 4 years of hospital clinical training in surgery and anesthesia, and I know from Iraqi colleagues who have actually been physicians in Iraq, which is that's one of the first and foremost. That's one of the biggest problems is that. Of the 36,000 physicians who were in Iraq at the time of the 2003 invasion, there's an estimated now 9,000 who are left treating, responsible for caring for millions. And the one of the big problems of this is that because many of the trained physicians were killed or left, you have residents, like I was, being responsible for the care of patients. And, you know, I found my residency to be quite taxing and difficult, and I ain't seen nothing compared to what these young physicians have to deal with. But that destruction of the whole healthcare system had a significant impact on the well-being of women and children, because these tend to be the population, the segments of the population who not only are most susceptible to violence, but also use the healthcare system the most. In particular, during the years of economic sanctions, it's very common for those in your audience who have kids. Little kids tend to get upper respiratory infections. So just breathing problems, and infections, or diarrhea, diarrheal diseases. This is not uncommon to have, an illness, or to catch a bug that causes, diarrhea. But, during the time of sanctions, 70% of the deaths of children under 5 years old resulted from these easily treatable diseases. Upper respiratory infections and diarrhea can both, most cases can often be treated with antibiotics and replacement of fluids, giving IV fluids. But during sanctions, you know, there were hospitals who ran out of pediatric needles. So it's very difficult, just as, and I cared mostly for adults, but just to place an IV in someone who's dehydrated in an adult can be quite a difficult thing. For little kids, when their veins collapse and you don't have needles small enough to access, this is, you know, kids can die simply from being dehydrated. And this is what doctors were seeing during that time. And that continues once the Americans came and were supposed to have brought liberation and democracy and massive improvements to Iraqi society, that persisted. And it continued to be 70% of the deaths of children under five were from easily treatable diseases like respiratory infections and diarrhea. Malnutrition, since the 1990s, beginning with economic sanctions and continuing through today, because of the lack of availability of foodstuffs, simply from the lack of security, the lack of that whole situation, again, malnutrition takes its toll, particularly on children who are growing. And if they don't get the proper nutrition, their bodies and another aspect of that is their minds don't develop as well as they can. I mean, that's what every parent wants for their child, is to give them the best shot at life. And from 1990 through 2005, there was a report issued, the State of the World Mothers Report in 2005, showed that the chance that an Iraqi child would survive past age five dropped faster in Iraq since 1990 than anywhere else in the world. And that was basically, that was, I think we can say that's U.S. policy, because that was the war and sanctions that were brought to Iraq on our behalf. So malnutrition, easily treatable diseases that they don't have the medications or healthcare access to treat. This became another thing with the healthcare system becoming run down. Hospitals became really filthy. And while I was with my family in 2006, I never went to the hospital. It was really, I probably shouldn't have gone at that time, because if anybody who wasn't happy with Americans, and there were plenty, understandably so, if anybody found out that there was an American staying at this particular house, I mean, I really could have potentially put my family in a great deal of danger. So they kept me inside most of the time. So I didn't go to the hospital, but one of my cousins was expecting her second child, and nobody wanted to stay in the hospital. The hospitals were filthy, and there's no security in the hospitals. It's just a subject to violence and criminality, the same as anywhere else. And it used to be one of the top healthcare systems in that part of the world. And it wasn't worth enduring the dangers of going to the hospital to see someone who might not have finished their training, and you might not get adequate care. And actually, this was a consequence for one of my uncles who fell and fractured his hip. And by the time that they could find adequate, a decent surgeon for him, it was beyond the point of the best time to do it is within 24 hours of the injury. And that time had passed. Ultimately, for other reasons, he did not get a replacement surgery, part of it being how miserable the hospitals are. And he passed away three months later. It's again, like, because before we showed up in 2003, the country was suffering under sanctions, and of course from the decades of political repression under the Ba'athist regime, but people had free health care and free education, this is, and they have security. They knew that, I mean, they could stay out into the late hours and not be concerned about any sort of criminality. I mean, that's, I guess, one of the perks of having such a restrictive society. But people could send their kids to school without worrying about them getting blown up by car bombs. This was, and then, of course, as I referred to earlier, the post-traumatic stress disorder. When we think of, that's usually discussed in the, if it's discussed, it's mentioned in the context of returning veterans, returning soldiers and Marines who come home with post-traumatic stress disorder. And there's an estimated, I think the last official figure is that 1 in 3 come back to the U.S. With PTSD. I would argue that it's much higher than that. But these are individuals who are sent into a war zone, who spend months to 1 or 2 years, depending on how many tours of duty they do, maybe more than a couple of years. But you're talking about children who grow up in that violent environment. They have no escape from it, and they know no alternative. And they also deal with the daily house raids that were initially, in the first part of the occupation, were conducted by U.S. forces, and then that was transitioned to Iraqi forces who were trained by the U.S. forces. So this is the kind of, this is the brutality and violence of a military occupation that that these kids are growing up with. So from all these aspects of life and the extreme poverty that's in Iraq, and then back to the services, it's very difficult to pursue an education when you're studying by candlelight. But also I have contact with a couple of people who just, the will is not there. They look around and they see how many friends they've lost, and there's sort of like a consideration of like, you know, well, what's it worth it? What is my life worth it? It's tremendous misery that I think really hasn't even been, I don't think I have even grasped. Even though I spent only a few months there, and I have tried to follow the situation, but I think the enormity of the toll that the Iraqi people have taken and continue, and they continue to experience, I really think that even I haven't fully grasped the extent of that. It's extensive.
All right, thank you. The U.S. imperialists, and you know, they have their various architects like Paul Bremer. And you mentioned earlier that there's a several hundred million dollar embassy, U.S. embassy that is in Iraq. So I wanted to ask you, what do you think the end game, the objective? What do you believe that the U.S. imperialists and the corporations that finance them, such as Monsanto, and I remember, you know, seeing a speech by yours where you were talking about the bounty of just wonderful dates that Iraq used to provide, you know, and how, because of Bremer and Monsanto, the whole pasta connection, and how things are changing, how that's impacted farmers. If you could, you know, elucidate to our viewers, like, all of that, you know, within the context of what do they have up their sleeves? What do these imperialists have? What kind of privatization are they planning?
Thank you for watching that presentation. That's basically in a number of areas, Iraq was chosen as a laboratory for corporations. Oftentimes, when there's a period, we've conducted a lot of covert wars, but before Afghanistan, to my knowledge, the last major offensive we had was the first Gulf War, and the first Gulf War was the last major offensive, the most recent offensive before that was Vietnam. And there are, in the years in between those, again, I realize there's tremendous covert operations, but for a massive assault in the interim period between our massive assault, there's all kinds of research and development going on with weapons manufacturers. And this is where a lot of American tax dollars are going, whether it's to Raytheon or Lockheed Martin or those two, the Boeing. Those are the ones that come to my head immediately. They're looking at new weapon systems. And then when we have an opportunity, which is basically an opportunity to see how well those new weapons work, this is people's lives on the ground that we're taking. So it's an experimental action from that standpoint. As you referred to, it's within the last, decade or so that genetically modified foods have really sort of emerged. I think I've learned about them in the last decade or so maybe the history is longer than that. But Iraq was also a laboratory for these Terminator seeds. These are seeds that were genetically engineered to grow plants that would not create new seeds, which is completely in defiance of nature. But it's in perfect unity or synchronicity with making corporate profits, because if your plants don't produce seeds, then you have to keep going back to the corporation to buy new seeds every year. These plants are also, they're genetically engineered to tolerate specific pesticides, also manufactured by Monsanto. So it's a whole chemically, genetically engineered system, and here's an opportunity to try it out on people. So weapons, new agricultural seed systems, these are the two that are coming to mind. But then, of course, you have what really became a massive business that was not so before the so-called war on terror, were these private security companies. Blackwater, which has changed its name several times, I think now it's owned by the company Academy, ACADEMI. Blackwater, DynCorp, there's another one, Triple Canopy. Just massive amounts of tax dollars going to supply them, and that really, you've become like private armies. So that whole industry has evolved. So really, continuing on, whether it's the continued occupation of Afghanistan or the continued control of Iraq, how did I forget the most obvious industry? The oil, Iraqi oil has been privatized. But I didn't mean to overlook one of the main purposes of invading Iraq. But from that standpoint, this is what the government in Iraq is doing today. The leaders are getting a cut of the profits, but Iraq's oil fields are being opened up to foreign companies for exploration. And the deals that they're cutting are beneficial to the oil companies. And as long as the leaders are getting rewarded as well, then they don't really. I think that what we've seen is we don't see that much concern for the people. And I could be describing Iraq. I could also be describing America from that standpoint. But this is in the 1970s, Iraq nationalized its oil, taking the profits back into Iraqi hands and putting it into the central government, which helped it to build up. Certainly there was corruption, and the government took a share. But there was also a lot of money invested in Iraq's infrastructure, which is how it developed such a strong healthcare and educational system. And so that happened in the 1970s, and I feel like this was the Western powers taking those monies back and taking those oil profits back. And British Petroleum was there before oil was nationalized, and now they're there again. So, and all these military operations continue, which I think also is part of the issue of weapons in America as well, is that there's big money in arms sales. So this is the core of it. It's corporate profit. And what are we willing to sacrifice for that? I'm not willing to sacrifice lots, not at all. And we have to acknowledge that it's not, we have to see what the ends are. We have to see all the ramifications of our actions. And the corporate media have done a very good job of hiding that reality from us. Because I believe that if we would see on the evening news the tragedies, the horrors, the massacres overseas that we are responsible for, if the American people saw that, they would react. They would react the same. Maybe not exactly the same, because we tend to be very nationalist here, but there would be compassion. There would be outrage. There would be a desire for that to end. In the same way that we don't want what happened in Newtown, Connecticut, or Aurora, Colorado, or at Columbine, at all these big killings in the U.S., the same sort of concept of we got to do something different, we got a problem, and so that's my hope, is that as more information gets out, we'll start to recognize what we need to do.
Right. You mentioned weapons. What is shock and awe?
Shock and awe is the Pentagon's word for terrorism. It's actually shock and awe was a position paper written by Harlan Ullman and James Wade. I think Ullman, mixing them up because I did research on this. One of them works at the National Defense University. But this is actually a position paper called Shock and Awe, Achieving Rapid Dominance. So it was a how-to on how do you terrorize a population, how do you have an impact on a population that makes them more conducive to being controlled. And by let's see, 2005, I think, the Pentagon had its definition of terrorism, which was essentially the same thing, using violence to coerce a population or a group of people. So it was very interesting to me that actually my cousins, and because I don't speak Arabic, so all the conversations happened in English. Thank goodness my cousins learned English, but they translated shock and awe back to me as shock and fear. So here in the U.S., you're like, oh, it's awesome. Like, look what our weapons can do. That's awesome. But for them, it was, they got the right translation, because they said it was shock and fear, and it's basically to induce fear in people. And we usually, when we think of that part of the world, of what's traditionally known as the Middle East, but it's a colonial term because it's relative to the colonial power. So I try to say Western Asia, but then nobody knows what I'm talking about. But anyway, we're talking about that part of the world. What the images that we see on the mainstream media tend to be young men. They are often angry. They often have their faces covered, so that's dehumanizing in itself. We cannot make a connection with them. They're often carrying weapons, and they're saying things that are anti-American. This is the image that we tend to be fed from that part of the world. But if we think about it, if you take any population, it's going to be about half men and half women. So if you add up the women, the girls, and the boys, this is the majority of the population, women and children. And when we don't see women and children in these TV clips, it's sort of a subtle distortion of the society, that it's young men who are violent and angry. But what we don't know is why they're so angry, which is oftentimes rooted in our foreign policy. But we also lose this connection of women and children and who is actually bearing the brunt of hardship, just because it's the majority of the population. This is purposeful, I think. It's dehumanizing. And when we are brought to see other peoples and other cultures as not less than our own, then I think we'll look at that. We'll get to a better place.
All right. Thank you. And I have a couple more questions for you, and I really appreciate your time today. But I really want our viewers to get a completely comprehensive idea in terms of the U.S. involvement in that part of the world where Iraq is. And so can you tell us what the U.S. involvement was during the Iraq-Iran war? And, you know, you even alluded to that, you know, Saddam Hussein was an ally. I mean, of the U.S. The U.S. was financing him. What, why, and when did this take place, and to what level was the U.S. involved?
So I'll start. I'll come up through the 1980s. If I can, I'll start a little bit before, I can't go too far before because my knowledge won't let me. Just starting in the 1960s. This was a time of, 1958 was the revolution in Iraq. This is when the British were officially finally kicked out the last time. And then through the rest of the 50s and the early 60s, then sort of a power vacuum, and the two major groups that emerged seeking power in Iraq were the socialists, the Ba'ath Party, and the communists. Now think of 1950s, 1960s, United States, and you have this tremendous fear of communism and the Red Scare and the concern over the Russian Empire. So the American government, watching what was going on there and emerging as a strong after World War II, really emerging as a powerful player on the global scene, and as the opposing superpower to the Russian Empire, they did not want to see the Communist Party come to power in the country where so much oil was sitting. So the CIA, according to a book by Tariq Ali called Bush in Babylon, the CIA was involved in trying to help the Ba'athists come to power, and so they needed a point man, and they found Saddam Hussein, a young man from Tikrit, who wanted power, who was also looking for a means to gain power in Iraq, and the U.S. was looking for a point person who might be supportive of U.S. policy. So we actually helped the Ba'athists rise to power. They officially came to power. The 60s were a period of several coups, but al-Bakr became president in 1968, and Saddam Hussein, who was his relative, was the second in command. But though he was second in command, he was really in charge. He was in charge of domestic affairs, the state security apparatus. So al-Bakr held the title of president, but Saddam Hussein was really running the show. And then, at that point, the U.S. was pleased with that. Then during the period of the 1970s, this was basically just to keep Iraq just keep a lid on Iraq, just to kind of hold them in place. They were not that much of a power at that time because they were just they were going through all these revolutions and emerging from colonial rule. But at this time, of course, in the 1960s and through the 70s, we are very closely allied with the Shah of Iran. And the American CIA was funding the very much feared state police in Iran. So we were very close with Iran. In 1979, Saddam Hussein assumed the presidency of Iraq. And in 1979, the Islamic theocracy in Iran was born. The Islamic Revolution took place, kicking out the Shah and replacing it with the rule by Khomeini, which was then theocratic rule, which was not friendly to the United States. So with that change in power in Iran, since it had lost the ally of the Shah, then the U.S. government was saying, all right, well, let's see if we can cozy up to the government in Iraq to sort of keep tabs on Iran, which was no longer an American ally. So this is when we really adopted a more friendly stance, a more open stance, a more sharing of arms stance with Iraq, and with tacit support from the United States and Saudi Arabia, Iraq was encouraged to attack Iran, which Saddam Hussein did in 1980. And so now we're not allied with Iran. We are allied with Iraq, and we're sharing conventional biological weapons with Iraq, satellite imagery. We're supporting Iraq officially in the Iran-Iraq war. But under the table, hidden from the American people and hidden from the U.S. Congress, there was a group in the Pentagon, but I'm not sure if it also spilled over into the administration. I think, well, Reagan said he couldn't remember anything, but we won't find out for sure. But there was a group in the Pentagon who decided that, well, if we arm both sides, that the benefit of that is that these two countries will keep each other busy, kill each other off, and not emerge as any threat to control of the resources of that part of the world. And another benefit they came up with was, we will sell arms to Iran secretly and then use the money that's made from that to fund the Contras, to oppose a democratically elected government in Nicaragua. And this is what the Iran-Contra scandal was. I don't remember exactly when it came to light. But basically what U.S. policy was officially arming Iraq and secretly arming Iran, and helped carry that war, helped make it drag out for 8 years. When the ceasefire was finally called and Iraq emerged as the official winner, although nobody won that, at this point, that only happened with the financial and military support in terms of satellite intelligence coming from the U.S. And during this time, after that's 1988, this is when, after now 8 years of war, Iraq is seeking to rebuild its infrastructure, which was, I mean, it had been, basically the country had been focused on war for 8 years, and they wanted to move forward, and the bosses had put together a $40 billion plan to move forward with rebuilding the country. But with Iran officially defeated, Iraq was then preparing to emerge as the superpower in that region. But I think the problem that, or a big problem that the U.S. had with Iraq was that Saddam Hussein maintained opposition to Israel. He maintained an anti-imperialist, anti-Zionist mentality, which was really the foundation, one of the early foundations of the Ba'ath Party. And this was not acceptable for U.S. policy in the region. So with Iraq preparing to be the big strong power in that part of the world, I believe that had it been Iraq or had it been another nation, that nation would have been targeted to be weakened. And then comes into the events between 1988 and August 2nd of 1990 when Iraqi troops moved into Kuwait. And as far as we knew in the U.S., this happened completely out of the blue. And Bush the First was calling Saddam Hussein a tyrant worse than Hitler, and that he was preparing to sweep through that part of the world, conquering the same way Hitler swept through Europe. And it's not that Saddam Hussein and his regime had not earned the reputation for massive human rights violations. There's no question of the brutality of the regime. But we didn't care about that while we were arming him during the 1980s. We turned a blind eye to that. And we've propped up many dictators around the world, regardless of their human rights violations, as long as they're towing the U.S. policies that supports the U.S. dollar, the U.S. economy. So there were basically, in that two-year period from 88 to 90, the conflict with Kuwait was brewing, and that was over three major issues. One was Kuwait gave Iraq $10 billion during the years of the Iran-Iraq War, and Kuwait said they wanted it back. They said it was a loan, and they wanted it back. And Iraq said, well, yeah, you supported us, but if Iran defeated Iraq, they were going to come through and get rid of the monarchy, because they thought the monarchies were contrary to Islam. So it was in Kuwait's interest to support the war effort for Iraq. This was the Iraqi government's argument. And that Iraq invested as well for 8 years in money and blood and were even. So they did not want to repay that $10 billion. The second was a longstanding territorial dispute between Iraq and Kuwait. This is from the time that the British carved the countries out of the sand and designating who would rule each area. But this is over decades. And actually on the border, during the Iran-Iraq War, the Kuwaitis pushed their border north. So Iraq was saying, you know, you confiscated some of our southern land. And the third issue was that Kuwait was slant drilling. From their side of the border, they were slant drilling at an angle under the border and into the Rumaila oil field, which is one of the largest oil fields in Iraq, and stealing oil. And the other major issue was that Kuwait was flooding the oil market. Iraq had this $40 billion plan to rebuild its infrastructure, and that money was going to come from oil sales, which was the bedrock of Iraq's economy. But with Kuwait flooding the oil market, selling oil beyond the standards set by OPEC, they were significantly dropping the price of oil. And for whatever reason, there's research done by Tariq Ali and by Ramsey Clark. The Kuwaitis would not budge on any of these issues, even in discussions with the Arab League. And ultimately, Saddam Hussein, this is argued, as he presented to the American ambassador in July, he argued that this is an economic war you're waging on Iraq. This is when he massed troops on the border, and August 2nd, 1990, Iraqi troops moved into Kuwait, and the response from the U.S. in particular, the West in general, was swift and massive, and 500,000 troops were amassed in the Gulf with over the next 5 months without any escalation, and then the Gulf War was launched in January of 1991, which devastated Iraq and the Iraqi people.
Thank you. Really appreciate that. My last question for you is, you know, we started off, you mentioned that your mother is Jewish, and you know your grandparents, you know, you differed from them in terms of their philosophy, because they openly said that they supported Zionist ideologies. And so I wanted to ask you to kind of try to bring things full circle, to get your thoughts on not just the recent Operation Pillar of Cloud that devastated Gaza, and not just Operation Cast Lead a few years ago that killed 1,400, you know, Palestinians, that the U.S. corporate media never mentions. They'll mention 13, you know, Israelis that were killed, and not even within that mentioning 7 of them were IDF forces. But in the same token, never mentioning, you know, that half of the people that were, the 1,400 that were killed, were actually children. What is the comparison? What are your thoughts? What is the comparison between that you see between Iraq, the occupation of Iraq, Afghanistan, what's going on right now in Syria, what happened in Libya, and drawing that like to Palestine, and why is the ongoing struggle to liberate Palestine, so that these people are able to determine their own destinies, that they don't have this brutal yoke of Israeli apartheid, just devastating man, woman, and child day in and day out. If I could, I know it's a loaded question, but I think it's an important one to ask.
It's a great question, I'll try to be succinct, but I really haven't throughout this interview. You've been very generous. I think the general theme, which people, some people don't really like the reference, because I guess colonialism, and I'm not a historian, but colonialism is officially defined as taking place in a previous era. But this is, fine, call it neocolonialism. I don't care what you call it. It's the same relationship. One of the pieces of information that was both eye-opening and frightening to me as I started to do more and more research, specifically on Iraq, was the Project for a New American Century, which is actually, I mean, these people are bold. They put it on the internet. so it's abbreviated PNAC, P-N-A-C. So anybody can, I haven't tried to access it in a while, but I've always been able to pull it up. But this was really a plan for the American empire in this century. And I really feel that all of these approaches, this is about economic superiority, and not approaches, all of these military actions, these military assaults are for Western economic supremacy, specifically American, protecting the American dollar. Afghanistan was about building a pipeline. This was another major issue. I mean, like, you can't talk to, I think still to this day, people are very resistant to hear anything, a different story other than, well, we have to get bin Laden. But that's another topic to bring up, which I'm also learning about, is the 9/11 truth movement. I don't believe bin Laden and Al Qaeda made the towers collapse. I don't believe they have the capacity to do what happened on that day. Especially one of the big question marks came with World Trade Center Building 7. So I would encourage your audience, if they haven't asked those questions before, to see what actually happened that day, and what investigating, you know, still has been left undone. But you said we were told Afghanistan was about getting bin Laden, but also liberating Afghan women. Well, to me, it never makes sense send in a military force comprised of predominantly young men, armed with M16s and the most sophisticated weaponry in the world, to go help women. This has really never been established as an effective tool, an effective method. is really about what Smedley Butler described, that war is a racket, and that he was strong arm for big business. That first the military goes in, and then the businesses go in to follow. And this has been our pattern since the late 1800s for the United States. Afghanistan was about, in Afghanistan, first I learned about the pipeline that they wanted to build to transport resources from in the Caspian Basin. But then it was found that Afghanistan has this incredible, the earth in Afghanistan holds a tremendous amount of minerals, like trillions of dollars worth of minerals. So that's economically prosperous. It should be economically prosperous for Afghanistan, but as a colonial nation, we want it. Iraq, we were told a few stories, but ultimately, well, we're going to help the Iraqi people. Blowing stuff up does not help the Iraqi people. Just as calling an airstrike to Newtown, Connecticut is not going to help the people in Connecticut. Airstrikes don't help people. Airstrikes kill people. So in Iraq, the main issues about invading Iraq were about controlling oil, not so much taking oil for ourselves, but controlling where Iraq's oil goes, in particular, controlling the flow of oil to the Far East, another colonial term, but the Pacific Rim countries, China and Japan. And the other big factor was Israeli national security. And Israel, which finally addresses your question, is basically our colonial outpost in the region. By having a very strong military there that has occupied and invaded Egypt, occupied and invaded, invaded and occupied Syria, invaded and occupied Palestine, invaded and occupied Lebanon, and has bombed Iraq, and I argue because of their presence in Iraq during shock and awe, have also invaded and occupied Iraq, that this is a means of strong-arming the nations in that part of the world and controlling their resources. And if you don't comply, then if the government in that part of the world and other parts of the world as well, we've done the same thing in Latin America, and we're also extending our reach with AFRICOM to African nations once again. If the governments don't want to comply with our policies, which it would make sense that a true democratic government would not, because a true democratic government in other parts of the world would seek its own economic stability, its own economic production, not everybody serving the United States. So governments that are not compliant will be targeted for regime change. But the U.S. mainstream, the government, the corporations, the media, they have done a very effective job of selling humanitarian intervention to the American people, that we're blowing people up for their own good, and we keep buying it. I'm not quite sure why. You know, it's one thing to have said, like, okay, like, wow, they really lied to us after 9/11, and they lied to us and told us Iraq was responsible for it, and you know, that was, yeah, we fell for that one. You know, that's misguided. But we fall for it again in Libya, and we're falling for it again in Syria, and we're falling for it again in Iran. I mean, that's it. There's no excuse for that. There just isn't. Not with the internet, not with the amount of information that's available. So this is our colonial plan, and unfortunately, it's the same old, same old. And again, this is not my original thought, but over the years, especially thought that I learned from my mom, is that really the only thing that changes in this battle of empires and the scourge of empires is the technology. And today, the U.S. Deals blows with weapons that are more heinous and terrifying than anything that's come before. So And I really think that we could do a lot better. We could do so much better. So we see images from Palestine and see images from these other occupied lands that serve the agenda of the corporation. And the good news is that slowly but surely, the truth is coming to light. So again, I'm so grateful for the opportunity to talk your ear off today and share what I've learned with your audience, because this is how the real truth gets out and hopefully inspires others to probably many of your listeners are already asking questions, but ask more and more questions, and it's definitely the questioning of the status quo is really increasing day by day. So it's not enough to save the suffering of today, but I do hope, and we have to be hopeful, that ultimately it will mean less suffering for tomorrow. So as much of a dent as I can put into the imperialist plans that I can in my lifetime, that will I'm going for everything I can. And again, thank you so much for the chance to speak with you today.
No problem. How do you how would you suggest that people seeing you for the first time, hearing your words for the first time, this unbelievable abundancy of information that you've provided, and now feeling compelled to do something on some small level, how would you, being a doctor, to put on your social justice stethoscope, how would you prescribe folks, make a dent themselves on a small level?
I think that the most important thing is to remember that don't think that one person cannot make an impact. One of my favorite lines that I don't know who said it was, if anyone who thinks something small cannot make a difference has obviously never been in bed with a mosquito. You can, we don't have the billions of dollars and we don't have the resources, but in that sphere that those who are profiting from these policies do, but we have great strength in other spheres. And then I have to say that for myself, my activism is trial and error. Like I said, in 2004, I just started showing family pictures to the people who were around me who I could, make sit down and say, please look at this with me. And they did, and they were receptive. So it was really just following my heart. And that, I don't mean to give you a lame answer, but if I say, well, your audience should do this, and you should write your congressperson, and you should, go to a demonstration, I don't think that solves anything. And I also think it could potentially, quash the interest, quash the excitement of the individual who wants to do something. Because if I tell you something you don't want to do, you're not going to do it, understandably so. So the best thing, the best advice, which is just so vague, is that, you have to follow your heart. And wherever your passion lies, whether it's politics, like me, or it's the arts, or it's the environment, or it's animals, anything. We have so much work to do on so many different levels. And if you're passionate about what you do, then that has its own effect on the people around you. And the hope is that that's a ripple effect that can really go out and make huge differences. Because I'm very, like I said, I'm so fortunate to have been able to travel the way I have. I go visit my family. My family can't get out of Iraq. I've had this opportunity, and I've then been given the opportunities to share it with others, and I feel extraordinarily lucky for that. Other people don't have the same opportunities, and even with the knowledge I have, if I don't have an audience, then it doesn't do much good. But if I can reach other people and they can pursue their avenue, of what they believe strongly in. I think that rather than thinking of the power of the empire as like a monster with so many different tentacles that we make no difference if we cut one off or two off, I see it more as a dam that we're chipping away at. And every little grain of sand or a little grain of rock that comes away from that dam is one step closer to a real revolutionary wave. Now, that may be naive, but I don't care. Anything's possible, and we have seen such revolutionary movements come before, and I think the time for, and it doesn't have to be, I don't mean like, you know, massive marching in the streets, I just mean like even with the change of consciousness, that might be enough, because we will reach the tipping point, I think, and I hope for this big shift. But if people have any questions, if I could shamelessly plug my website, liberatethis.com, and my email is info@liberatethis.com. You can also find me on Facebook, and I am working on one of the reasons that I have access to some information, even though some of it was a little fuzzy, is that I'm working on a book, and so I hope you might stay tuned for when that comes out. Fingers crossed for 2013. I've been working on it for a couple of years, so but I'll definitely keep you posted. And maybe that book will give inspiration for someone else to move forward and to follow their heart, which is really the most important thing. And that we change our policies to let other people have the chance to live their lives and follow their own hearts as well.
Thank you so much, before we sign off, I want to say that once that book comes out, since that book is most likely not going to be featured on Oprah's Book of the Month Club because of its content, you are more than welcome. We would love to have you come back on to deconstruct that book and talk about its contents and try to use this as a vehicle to get the book out to many people that otherwise might not even know the book exists.
I greatly appreciate that, and I mean, you'll hear me. I will be making announcements everywhere. You might hear me screaming it when I'm done with the book. I'm so ready to be done, but I really appreciate that so much. That's a wonderful, just like today, it's another great opportunity. I'm very grateful.
Thank you so much. That's Dr. Dahlia Wasfi. I'm Solomon Kamajan, and on behalf of Your World News, this is Critical Insight. Thank you so much, Doctor, for coming on. We appreciate it. And thank you, viewers, for tuning in. Take care.
Take care.
We have an obligation to every last victim of this illegal aggression because all of this carnage has been done in our name. Since World War II, 90% of the casualties of war are unarmed civilians, a third of them children. Our victims have done nothing to us. From Palestine to Afghanistan to Iraq to Somalia to wherever our next target may be, their murders are not collateral damage. They are the nature of modern warfare. They don't hate us because of our freedoms. They hate us because every day we are funding and committing crimes against humanity. The so-called war on terror is a cover for our military aggression to gain control of the resources of Western Asia. This is sending the poor of this country to kill the poor of those Muslim countries. This is trading blood for oil. This is genocide. And to most of the world, we are the terrorists. In these times, remaining silent on our responsibility to the world and its future is criminal. And in light of our complicity in the supreme crimes against humanity in Iraq and Afghanistan and ongoing violations of the UN Charter and international law, how dare any American criticize the actions of legitimate resistance to illegal occupation? Our so-called enemies in Afghanistan, Iraq, Palestine, our other colonies around the world, and our inner cities here at home are struggling against the oppressive hand of empire, demanding respect for their humanity. They are labeled insurgents or terrorists for resisting rape and pillage by the white establishment, but they are our brothers and sisters in the struggle for justice. The civilians at the other end of our weapons don't have a choice, but American soldiers have choices. And while there may have been some doubt 5 years ago, today we know the truth. Our soldiers don't sacrifice for duty, honor, country. They sacrifice for Kellogg, Brown, and Root. They don't fight for America. They fight for their lives and their buddies beside them because we put them in a war zone. They're not defending our freedoms. They're laying the foundation for 14 permanent military bases to defend the freedoms of ExxonMobil and British Petroleum. They're not establishing democracy. They're establishing the basis for an economic occupation to continue after the military occupation has ended. Iraqi society today, thanks to American help, is defined by house raids, death squads, checkpoints, detentions, curfews, blood in the streets, and constant violence. We must dare to speak out in support of the Iraqi people who resist and endure the horrific existence we brought upon them through our bloodthirsty imperial crusade. We must dare to speak out in support of those American war resistors, the real military heroes who uphold their oath to defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, including those terrorist cells in Washington, D.C., more commonly known as the legislative, executive, and judicial branches. Frederick Douglass said, "Those who profess to favor freedom and yet depreciate agitation are people who want crops without plowing the ground. They want rain without thunder and lightning. They want the ocean without the roar of its many waters. The struggle may be a moral one, or it may be a physical one, or it may be both, but it must be a struggle. Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never has, and it never will. Every one of us must keep demanding, keep fighting, keep thundering, keep plowing, keep speaking, keep struggling until justice is served. No justice, no peace. No justice, no peace. No justice, no peace.
I got a letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it and burned that. Man, the way that I live, no concern that. Man, we gon' have to settle this another way. A letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it and burned that. Man, the way that I live, no concern that. Man, we gon' have to settle this another way.
Movement, music, move into it. Put a fist up, prove it to us. This is much more than music to us. This is